Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. May the Lord bless you. And you that's listening out in the radio listen audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We hope in doing the hour coming up, we can be an inspiration to everyone here and also out in the radio listening audience. Now, you that's out there listening by medium of radio, if you get on your phone and call a friend, maybe a shut-in, have them to tune in and get the hour coming up, we'll try to be a blessing to them. You'll be doing them a great favor. So we appreciate you tuning in, appreciate your presence here today. Now, if you have your Bible, I want you to turn to the book of Genesis. I'm going to speak today on the subject, the woman eavesdropped on her husband and what she heard made her laugh. The woman eavesdropped on her husband and what she heard made her laugh. That's what I'm speaking about today. And you turn to Genesis chapter 18 for the reading of God's word. While you're turning there, let me mention just a few of our cassette tape. Now, we're taping, of course, all Sunday morning programs. You get the music, the singing, and the message on the tape. We send these tapes out for a gift of $3 each. And the gift is used to help pay for radio time and to help buy other tape and stamps and so forth. And we work us together in getting out the gospel. I'll mention just a few of our latest tape. Tape number 211, He Being Dead Yet Speaketh. Tape number 212, The Person That Was a Was Not. Tape number 213, The Man That Pitched a Drunk and Brought a Curse on His Family. Tape number 214, What We Should Know About Fishing for Men. Tape number 215, The Man Who Commanded His Family After Him. Tape number 216, Tongues and the Charismatic Movement. I brought a message last Sunday on the tongues and the charismatic movement. Everybody needs to hear this message and get it on cassette tape. It's tape 216. One of the most dangerous movements we have in the land today is the charismatic movement. And you need to know about that, why it is so dangerous. And you can write it right in for the tape. And tape number 216, a tape on tongues and the charismatic movement. We send it out to you at your request for a gift of $3 to help defray our radio expense. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. So you write to me this coming week. I appreciate it very much. Now in the book of Genesis chapter 18, and the Lord appeared unto him in the plains of Mamre, and he sat in the tent in the heat of the day. Now the hymn here is none other than Abraham, of course. And he lifted up his eyes and looked, and lo, three men stood by him. And when he saw them, he ran to meet them from the tent door and bowed himself toward the ground and said, My Lord, if now I have found favor in thy sight, pass not away, I pray thee, from thy servant. Let a little water, I pray ye, be fetched and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Now we'll fetch a morsel of bread and comfort ye your hearts. After that ye shall pass on, for therefore you are come to your servant. And they said, So do as thou hast said. And Abraham hastened into the tent unto Sarah and said, Make ready quickly three measures of fine meal, kneaded, and make cakes upon the earth, upon the hearth. And Abram ran unto the herd and fetched a calf tender and good, and gave it unto a young man, and he hastened to dress it. And he took butter and milk, and the calf which he had dressed, and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree, and they did eat. And they said unto him, Where is Sarah thy wife? And he said, Behold, in the tent. And he said, I will certainly return unto thee according to the time of life. And lo, Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent door, which was behind him.
Abraham and Sarah were old and well stricken in age, and he ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. Therefore Sarah laughed within herself, saying, after I am waxed old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also? And the Lord said unto Abraham, wherefore did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I be sure to bear a child which am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the time appointed, I will return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son. Now that's reading through verse 14 of Genesis chapter 18, and I hope you follow me in the scriptures. Now you'll see here that three men, the Lord and two angels, the Lord being in angelic form and the two angels, and he told Abraham, and Abraham was an old man and Sarah was an old woman. He said, you're going to have a son. Sarah is going to conceive and you bear your son. And Abraham, or rather Sarah, was eavesdropping in the tent, trying to hear, no doubt, what they were talking about. You know, some women are kind of like that. They want to hear what's going on in the other room if somebody's visiting their husband. And so she listened, and she heard the Lord tell Abraham that she would conceive and bear him a son, and she laughed. That's kind of funny to her, being an old woman and didn't give birth to a child. So sometimes you need to be kind of careful about eavesdropping. You're liable to hear something you won't hear, like to hear. I remember the late, great Joe Parson going on to be with the Lord. He's telling about one time he went to a place for a meeting. He was sitting there in the living room, and some of the women were in another room, and he heard them call his name. They were talking about him, and he was anxious to hear what they were saying. So he listened very attentively, and this is what they said. One of them said, I'll tell you now, said, he may be a good preacher, but he's about the ugliest man I've ever seen. Well, sometimes you hear something you don't want to hear. Many years ago, I was in a meeting in Valdosta, Georgia. I was staying in a home, an old-fashioned home, where the porch is built almost around the entire house. It's in the summertime, and that afternoon after lunch, I lay down to rest a few minutes right near a window there on the porch, and the old gentleman and his wife, in whose home I was staying, they came out and sat down in the old-fashioned rocker. And evidently, they forgot about me being in the room and could hear what they were saying through the window. And the lady said this, said, you know, he's a good preacher, but I'll tell you now, he sure does look like a Jew to me. Well, sometimes you hear things that maybe you don't want to hear. I remember the old gentleman that, well, went completely deaf. He couldn't hear thunder. His dear old wife died, and he had to go live with his children. Unbeknownst to them, after some time, of course, they could talk as loud as they wanted to, and he couldn't hear a thing they said. They knew it. And he went and got him a hearing aid. You're coming along with your hearing aid. He said, doing fine. The doctor said, well, what do your family think about it? He said, well, they don't know I have it. He said, in fact, Dennis, I've changed my will three times since I got this hearing aid. So sometimes people might be listening whenever you don't know they're hearing what you're saying, so you better be careful. Now, Sarah was listening. She was trying to hear what Abraham was saying and what those three men, the Lord and the two angels, were saying out there under the tree. And she got tickled about it, and just to think about having a child when she is of old age, and she couldn't hardly believe that, and she kind of doubted it, but it came to pass anyway. Now, we find in the Bible some great women that loved God and served God, and we thank God for them. We have them today that's doing likewise. And the Bible tells us that Sarah served God along with her husband Abraham. Now, he was the father of the Hebrew nation. In a sense, she was the mother of the Hebrew nation. We find other great women in the Bible that served God faithfully. We find that Abigail and Ruth were two great women. Abigail worked with King David and got the job done for God. And Ruth, of course, served the Lord. And when she married the man she married, then, of course, she worked with him in serving God. And that's always wonderful when husband and wife can work together to get the job done for God. The Bible says in Luke chapter 1, verse 6, talking about Zacharias and Elizabeth, They were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord blameless. Here you have the two working together to do things for God. That's wonderful. Now, if you have a husband that'll work with you in serving God, you're fortunate. You're wonderful. Many precious women have to serve God without their husbands helping them in any manner. And you have to appreciate them going on and serving the Lord, whether their husband do or not. And then you have some men that serving God, and their wives won't cooperate with them and go along with them in serving the Lord. Yet those men go right on and serve God anyway. Now you have to appreciate men that'll do that. Don't let anything stop you from serving God, whether it be your husband, your wife, or your children, or your parents, or whatnot. You need to serve the Lord. I read a story some time ago about Catherine Booth and William Booth that established the Salvation Army yon in England many years ago, whenever they were working for God, and they were going down into the ghettos and winning people to God and helping those people, giving them clothes and food, and the hierarchies in the church didn't like it. And they called them in and they said, "Now we're going to turn you out of the church if you don't stop going to the ghettos. We don't want those people in here. We don't want to have anything to do with that bunch of crumbs down there." And they said, "You got to stop, or we're going to turn you out of the church." And his little wife Catherine was back in the balcony, and they had the William up there before the men, the church leaders. And they said to William, they said, "William, are you going to stop serving the people in the ghettos?" And his wife cupped her hands over her mouth from the back, and she said, "Say no, William, say no, say no." William said, "No, I'll not stop serving those people. I'll go down and win everyone I can to God and do what I can to help them in their need." That little woman standing back there encouraged her husband to say no. And of course the church turned them out, but they went on and served God anyway. Now it's always good when you have encouragement from your wife in serving the Lord. It's a battle. It's discouraging if your wife is not encouraging and helping you in serving the Lord. And the same things applied to the wife when the husband will not. But we find that Abraham and Sarah served the Lord together. Now she had some impediments. She had great faith in God, but she had some impediments, no doubt about that. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 11, "Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised." And so she believed. Now she doubted to begin with, but the Lord rebuked her for her unbelief, and she believed God for a period of time, and especially as she conceived until the child was born. She exercised great faith in God. Now she had these impediments. Number one, she was barren. She could bear no children. She lived with her husband for many, many years unto ripe old age and could not bear him any children. That was hard on her because it was a reproach to any woman in Bible days that could not give birth to a son for her husband. And that grieved a woman. That almost grieved Rachel unto death. She told Jacob, said, "Give me children, I'm going to die." He said, "I'm not God. God will have to do that." And of course, it grieved her heart. And so we find here that Sarah went all these years and lived with her husband many years, a barren woman that could not conceive and bear children, and that grieved her heart. She wondered how her husband felt about it. She knew it must affect him. And then, of course, in her old age, she had faith in God to believe that God would do what he said. You find some unbelief in Genesis chapter 18, as I read in your hearing. And she encouraged Abraham later on, even after God had promised to give them a child, the devil made her doubt. Now the devil will make you doubt. You may make a vow to God. You may promise something. You may believe something today. And if you're not careful, the devil will have you doubting tomorrow. Now you say, "God, I believe it. It's going to happen. I believe it. I believe it with all my heart." The devil may corner you all sometime next week and rob you of that belief if you're not careful. And so you need God's help every minute. And that's what happened to Sarah. She believed that she was going to have a child. And time moved on, and she was very old, and still no child. No child. She called Abraham in, and she said, "Now, Abraham, if we're going to have that son that God promised that he would give us descendants, and would populate the earth, and our descendants would be as the stars of heaven and the sand of the seashore for number," then she said, "It looks like I'm not going to bear a child for you. You might as well go ahead and take Hagar, the maid here in the home, and marry her, and let her bear a child." Now, when they went to Egypt, they, of course, brought Hagar out of Egypt. She was an Egyptian maid, and she waited upon Sarah and the family. And so Abraham, instead of believing God like he should, he listened to his wife. Now, when you know the will of God and know what you should do, you should appreciate your wife's advice and take in consideration. But if you know the will of God, you shouldn't let her cause you to decide not to do what you know God wants you to do. You should do what the Lord wants you to do, regardless of how much she might say, "Well, I don't think it's going to work out. I don't think it's right." If you know it's the will of God, you stick to the will of God. Now, Abraham, instead of sticking to the will of God like he should have, he listened to Sarah, and he went ahead and married Hagar. And there was a son born to Hagar, and his name was Ishmael. Now, Ishmael, of course, there in the home was a little boy running around playing in the home. And as soon as Sarah saw that Hagar had conceived, and she was going to bear Abraham a child, she became very jealous of Hagar. She mistreated her. She ran away from the tent. And she told Abraham, "We're not going to keep her here." But finally, that boy was born. And Ishmael was 13 years old. And then Sarah gave birth to Isaac. Finally, God came and did what he had promised to do, although she doubted. Now, when Isaac was born in that home, Ishmael was 13 years old, and Isaac was born. And then they began to fuss and quarrel as they grew up. Those little fellas, they couldn't get along. They kept up a fuss in the home all the time. And finally, Sarah said to Abraham, "We'll never have any peace here. There'll never be any peace in this home as long as that woman is here and that boy is here. You got to get rid of them." Poor old Abraham, he had had enough problems. His heart was grieved, and the reason the boy was there, because she insisted that he marry Hagar. And there he was, put on the spot. But he had to take him out in the wilderness and leave him out there in the wilderness. Poor old Abraham, with a broken heart, carried Hagar and carried Ishmael out in the wilderness and left them out there and came back home to live with Sarah and Isaac. Now all the Arabs you have in the Middle East today, they are descendants of Ishmael. The Jews are descendants of Isaac. And they have been fussing and quarreling and fighting from the time that Isaac and Ishmael fussed and quarreled in the tent of Abraham. That's exactly where it started. And it's been going on ever since, and worse now than it's ever been. Over there, they're fussing, they're quarreling, they can't get along. The descendants of Ishmael, the descendants of Isaac, they're still bickering and fighting and quarreling and fussing. And they'll continue to do that until the Antichrist comes on the scene and solves the problem. When the Antichrist comes on the scene, he'll solve that problem temporarily, but they'll fuss until that time. And it started there in the tent of Abraham, been going on ever since. And there's no need to try to settle the dispute between Israel and the Arabs over there. It'll never be settled. Never, it never has, and it never will, until the Antichrist takes over and solves that problem, which he will do the first 3.5 years of his reign upon the earth. And so we find here then the fussing started, and of course they had to carry that boy out and leave him in the wilderness, and the Bible said his hand to be every man against his brother, so they've been fighting among themselves ever since that time. But this woman, Sarah, did exercise faith in God. Through faith, Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed. That is all by faith. She was an old woman, past the time of women to conceive. But by faith, she believed that she'd have that son, conceive and give birth to that son, and she did. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 11, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, received strength because she was kind of weak, she was old, and yet she conceived seed. And then In her old age, she trusted God. In Romans chapter 4, verse 17, the Bible says all things are possible with God. In Mark chapter 9 and verse 23, all things are possible to him that believe. Now, the matter of faith in God worked bigger in her body. When she had faith in God, believing she would conceive and bear that child, God began to give her strength. Now, as your day is, so shall your strength be. Now, every mother, every expectant mother should look to God every day for strength to carry the child and bear the child. You should be constant in prayer about that every day. You should wait on God. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And so say the waiting on God. Every day God would give us strength until the full 9 months is up. She received that strength, and then she had faith to deliver that child in good health. Now we find another woman in the Bible that God answered her prayer by the name of Rachel. Rachel told Jacob, said, Jacob, if you don't give me a child, I'm going to die. He said, I'm not God. If we have any children, Rachel, if I have any children by you, God will have to take over. And so she prayed, and finally God heard and answered her prayer. And God gave them one of the greatest men that ever lived, by the name of Joseph. You know the story of Joseph. He was born to Rachel and Jacob. And then Rachel said, the Lord's going to give me another child. And later on she conceived, and there she gave birth to Benjamin. But while she was giving birth to Benjamin, her soul slipped out of her body and went on to be with the Lord. She died in childbirth. And they have a tomb over there now just out of Jerusalem, between Jerusalem and Bethlehem. I passed by that tomb many, many times in my Holy Land tours. And now those Jewish women that are expecting children will go to that tomb sometime during the period of time they're carrying the child. They'll go to Rachel's tomb and pray that God will see them through childbirth. They believe if they'll do that, God will see them through childbirth, and they do that. Now Rachel died giving birth to that child Benjamin and went on to be with the Lord. Now in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 8, bodily exercise profit little, but godliness is profit unto all things, having promised the life that now is and that which is to come. So by faith, she believed that God would give her strength as she sojourned, and she prayed for the life to come. God's people every day should claim strength to serve God through faith day by day. In Isaiah chapter 27 and verse 5, let him take hold of my strength, God said. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, be strong in the Lord in the power of his might. In Job chapter 8 and verse 7, though thy beginning was small, yet thy latter end shall be greatly increased. And then that great verse in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. And in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 1, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Now we need strength every day. As we grow older, we need strength as we grow older. And mothers-to-be, they need extra strength every day on up until the child is born. And they need to pray that God will see them safely through childbirth and the child will be healthy. That doesn't happen in every family. Sometimes children are born that are not healthy. Sometimes mothers are going into eternity, are going to be with the Lord, giving birth to a child. That's happened many, many times. It's not as quite as dangerous today as it used to be, because of the medical knowledge in the hospitals and so forth. But you need to pray. Pray for the unborn child every day. That should be a prayer of an expectant mother. Now we find here in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 11, and was delivered of a child. She trusted God from conception unto deliverance. From conception unto deliverance. She trusted God and believed God and prayed to God. She had no abortion, no miscarriage. She went on and prayed, and God took care of her. Now that's a time when women need to really trust God, because childbirth, the pain and the agony and the travail and the danger of childbirth is placed upon the woman because, are you listening? Because Eve listened to the devil, ate of the forbidden fruit, and then gave to Adam, and he did eat. And God said, Eve, because you did that very thing, you wouldn't have to suffer childbirth and all the agony and the problems
and the sorrows and the heartaches and the travail and the pains that come upon a mother when she gives birth to her child is because of Mother Eve sinning in the Garden of Eden. That's a curse that's put up on women for that reason. Oh, you may say, now preach, Edwards, well, how about Adam? Was he left out? No, no. God said, Adam, because you listened to Eve, you knew better, you ate the forbidden fruit, for that reason, you're going to have to go out and make your living by laboring, working, and toiling, and sweating to make a living. And from that time until now, when you see a man working and sweating and toiling and worrying because of his job, that's put upon him because of what Adam did in the garden. Now, when Adam and Eve was placed in the Garden of Eden, they had no work to do. They just walked around, lived in the garden, enjoyed the fruit. Everything is wonderful, nothing to worry about. And God said, Adam, that's going to be changed. And because you listen to Eve, you're going to make your living by the sweat of your face, of your brow. You're going out and have to labor to make a living. And every time you see a man working and sweating, I don't care what he's doing, whether he's digging a ditch, driving a truck, or whatever he's doing, he's working to make a living, and that was placed on him because he listened to Eve back there in the garden, and that's a curse that God put on him. And so we find Eve, she had to go through childbirth, that is, suffer childbirth, all women likewise, and then Adam had to labor for a living. It's been that way ever since, never been changed, it's still the same. We find in the Bible that Rachel died in childbirth. The wife of Phinehas died in childbirth, and that's a sorrow and travail that comes upon the woman. Now listen to this verse. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 16, unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception in sorrow, thou shalt bring forth children. But the Bible also said that she would be saved in childbearing. In 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15, now listen to this promise. It said, notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue the faith. Now, what is meant by that verse is talking about what Mother Eve did in the garden and said, the woman shall be saved by childbearing. Now, what is meant by that? That doesn't mean that because she's given birth to children, she'll go to heaven. Doesn't mean that at all. It simply means that a woman will bear a child if he put on this earth. His name will be Jesus, and he'll be the Savior, and people can be saved because of this childbearing. That's what happened when Mary gave birth to the Son of God. He was placed on the earth, and now women and men can be saved because of childbearing. That is, that Mary gave birth to Jesus. He was the Son of God. He came, he was the Savior, and now you can repent and be saved because Jesus Christ is the Savior. Now notice the foundation of her faith. Because she had judged him faithful who had promised, the Bible said. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 4, faithful is he that calls you, he will also do it. That's nothing too hard for the Lord. Now we find that God is not bound by nature. He called water out of a rock. He caused an iron to swim in the water. And God is not bound by nature. God can do what he chooses. There's nothing too hard for the Lord. God proved that in Sarah's case. And although she was old and past childbearing, there was nothing too hard for the Lord. She conceived and she gave birth to Isaac. Isaac gave birth to Jacob. And Isaac's wife gave birth to Jacob, Rebekah. And then, of course, there was Jacob and Rachel, from which came the 12 tribes of Israel on down the line. And later, the Savior. And she had great faith in God. Now in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, I want you ladies to remember this scripture. You might mark it, you might read it. It'll tell you how to help win your husband to God. If you'll abide according to these verses, you might win him to God. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. Jot that down. Some of you women out in the radio listening audience, you'd like to see your husband saved? Jot down 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, that'll help you tremendously. In verse 6, and even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are, as long as you do well. That word obey means paid close attention to what Abraham said. Sarah paid close attention to what Abraham said. She listened to his advice. She listened well.
and she paid close attention to what he said in obedience and serving God as they walked together. And then if you read Galatians chapter 4, verses 19 through 31, you'll find through Sarah came the great liberty of faith, and God gives the example there. I want to pass something on to you here that I have before me today, and I want you to listen closely, and it's held in sacred memory. Now listen, will you please? Many years ago in London, a prominent woman died. Her body was brought to the largest auditorium in the city so that people could come and pay their last respects. Representatives of the Queen and many dignitaries of the courts walked past the coffin. Then the doors were opened to the commoners. Hundreds filed into the hall, quiet and respectful. Among them was a woman whose shabby dress and ragged shawl betrayed her deep poverty. Standing by the casket, she bowed her head and began to weep. She remained there so long that the crowd behind her became restless and impatient. One of the attendants quietly put a hand on her shoulder and said, "Madam, you must move on. You're stopping the people." Turning around, she replied, "I must stay here a little longer. I've walked 40 miles to see this woman's face once more. God used her to save my boys from hell. I can never thank him enough for what she's done. Please let me be here a few more moments." The people sensed her deep sorrow and were filled with sympathy and understanding, and some began to cry. You see, the noble servant of God whose body lay there in death was none other than Catherine Booth of the Salvation Army. That great woman that meant so much and salvation to so many. There, this poor woman had walked 40 miles to see her face one more time. She was used to win her two sons to God. She said, "Please let me stay here just a little longer. That woman kept my sons out of hell." And she held up that long line. And as she wept, they wept with her. Catherine Booth was a great woman, will always be remembered by the people in England and all over the world. She and her husband, William, established the movement today known as the Salvation Army that's known all over the world. Sarah was a great woman. God today is still looking for great women. You can be a great woman if you really want to be in service for God. And I trust you do want to be. And may God help you as you do so and desire to do so. And we thank God for our good women. We'd be hard up against it in our churches if we didn't have good women to help us in getting the job done for God. Thank you. You've listened well. Stand to your feet. Our Father, I pray today that you'll use the message. Thank you for the faith of great women today that love you and serve you. Bless them, our Father. We thank you for the privilege of serving thee, and we pray that you speak to every heart today that's listened to the sound of my voice. And God, may much be accomplished. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, Debbie's going to play for us on the organ, and she plays. If you're in this building, you're unsaved, backslidden, you want to join this church for any reason, you want to come forward, you may do so as she plays for us. As we wait, you may come. Anyone, for any reason. God is speaking, would you come? You're not saved, you ought to get saved. You're backslidden on God, you should come back to the Lord. You don't have a good church home, would you consider Northside?